Good morning, and welcome to Storrstown Presbyterian Church. So glad to be with you today. We are not live streaming the service today. We are having an outdoor service in our chapel. So this service has been pre-recorded so that you'll have a chance to watch it at home. We are very thankful for all that we've been able to do with our technology, and thankful to you at home who've been faithful at checking in and keeping up with our worship. Today, as we talk and think about worship in our sermon, we're really grateful for the opportunities we've had in this pandemic to be able to worship through the wonders of technology. So today, we're pre-recording this service. There are a couple of announcements in the bulletin, which you should have received by email. If you would like to be on our email list, please send an email to stpresby@verizon.net. stpresby@verizon.net, and we'll be happy to include you on our email list. Today, after worship, the session will be meeting for prayer and discernment as we think about the next stages in our church life. We have gone through a number of big events in the last couple of years. We've paid off our mortgage, we have survived a pandemic, and now we're kind of catching our breath and thinking about what's next. So please pray for our leadership in this time of discernment, and we look forward to some new tasks and some new goals for this next season of our church life. This morning, our call to worship comes from Psalm 96. It is a psalm about worship. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless God's name. Tell of God's salvation from day to day. Declare God's glory among the nations, the Lord's marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. The Lord is to be revered above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Worship the Lord in holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Let us pray. Wonderful and glorious Lord God, we turn our attention, the thoughts of our minds to you, to your kingdom, to the wonders of your glory, to the kindness of your grace. We turn our hearts to you, and we declare our allegiance to you by gathering in worship, by setting aside this time that we might proclaim your name to the nations. Lord, we turn our will to you. We bow our hearts in obedience to you, and we listen for your word for our lives. We all know, Lord, that you are the gracious one, the mighty one, the great provider. And so we set aside our wishes and our will, and we say, not my will, but your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, O Lord. So we gather in worship and proclaim your greatness, and we sing your praise. For we offer these words in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Today is from Romans chapter 1, verses 19 through 23. Paul is making an argument that God has revealed God's self to the people, to the Jewish people through the law and through nature, to all the rest of the world, to the Gentiles. Listen now for God's word. Since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that people are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images made to look like mortal people and birds and animals and reptiles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Light of the world, you stepped down into darkness, opened my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my soul upon that cross. And here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether worthy, altogether lovely, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether worthy, altogether lovely, altogether wonderful to me.
Imagine a beautiful spring day, sometime in May when the flowers are in bloom and life is overflowing. Families in our community are busier than busy, busy finishing up schoolwork, busy getting ready for graduations or proms, busy getting ready to gather kids home from college, busy getting ready for summer plans, planting gardens, doing the outdoor chores, getting ready for summer. Imagine that kind of busy time of year. And on the weekend, some take advantage of a nice day to go out and do some recreation, to get outdoors and bike or hike or go for a walk. Some take time for family gatherings, for a picnic or an outing. Some need to do extra lawn work, some need an extra nap. But some, something like 20%, some do something completely different, something a little weird. They gather in places like this for worship. They gather in places to do something that is so strange and bizarre to so many in our world. They worship. They bow their hearts to God. They offer their lives in service. They reconnect with the Spirit of the God in whom we live and move and have our being. They worship. Now, there are plenty of people in our world who will tell you that worship or at least church, is important. Something like 45% of the U.S. population say they go to church on any given Sunday. But in reality, only about 20% actually make it to church, actually take that time out each Sunday. They separate themselves from their neighbors. They set aside all the other things the world tells them to do, to be with family, to be at work, to be taking care of yourself, to be doing recreation. They set aside all of the other things and they worship. There are things that make us different as Christians. Things that make us a little out of step with other people in our community. Those habits set us apart, and one of those habits is our worship. This morning we're going to think about that. Imagine a Venn diagram, you know, one of those big circles. And in this circle we could put all the people who are religious or spiritual. It's a pretty big group. There are lots of people who would, in some sense of the word, identify as religious or spiritual. But then a smaller circle in that big circle would be people attached to an organized religion, Jewish, Islam, Christian, other organized religious groups. It would be a somewhat smaller circle, especially among younger people who think of themselves as spiritual, but not religious. And then inside that circle, an even smaller circle of people who are Christian. And inside that circle, an even smaller circle of those who identify as Christian who worship on a regular basis. Those who have the habit of worshiping make up that small circle within Christians, within religious groups, within spiritual, within all the people of our nation. Christian worship is one of the things that set us apart. And over this pandemic year plus, we've had a chance to think about that. It has been something that has been essential for keeping many of us connected to one another and to God. It has been so essential that we have bent over backwards to live stream and post worship services and gather in our homes. And though it has not been the same as gathering in this space, the idea of worship has been important to us. There's no one historically correct way to worship. The oldest liturgy, that is the oldest work of the people, the oldest pattern of worship, is probably observed today in the Greek Orthodox Church. But even that form of worship that dates back to the 4th or 5th century was not exactly like the early Christians. The earliest Christians had all the same common elements, but probably gathered in very simple ways. In all of our worship, across the spectrum of Christian churches, we take time for prayers, hymns, psalms, spiritual songs, readings, interpretation of the Bible. And we have traditional rituals like communion, baptism, anointing, prayer, common meals. But still, there's a great deal of variation in how those elements have been put together over the years. There are churches today that gather in people's homes, where four or five sit around a kitchen table, or a dozen or so sit around a living room. They gather not as strangers, but as an intimate group, a real family of Christ. And there are churches on the other extreme that meet in football stadiums, where the sound echoes around the hall. There, the power and glory of God The excitement of Christian worship is felt in the spectacular size and the huge affirmations from people, as well as grand speakers and professional singers. There are churches that worship with no electric instruments, and other churches that have full rock bands with special lighting. There are those not too far away from us that meet in barns, and they often gather for the entire day as not just the worshiping people, but as the real community of people. There are those who hold hands and hug, and those who speak in tongues. There are those who sit in silence, who sit still and separate from others. The practice of Christian worship is diverse, but Christians worship. Christians worship. And what I mean is that it's not the same as going to church or being in a building or going to a religious service. Christians worship. There are times when I'm in church and I'm not worshiping. I'm busy thinking about what I'm going to say, or busy thinking about what comes next, or busy worrying about the rest of my life, or busy thinking about one of my church members, but I'm not really worshiping. And there are times, certainly times during this pandemic, where we have been at home and we have been fully engaged in worshiping our God, where we have been attentive to God. There are times when we worship in beautiful cathedrals and simple churches, and times when we are so deeply impressed by the magnitude and glory of God in creation. That reading from Romans says, "Ever since the creation of the world, his eternal power and divine nature, invisible though they are, have been understood and seen through the things he has made." But that reading goes on to point out that just because God is there in creation doesn't mean that people always acknowledge God as the God of their lives. For though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking and their senseless minds were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools. So I say, Christians worship. Meaning we adore, we are attentive to, we are thinking about, we are proclaiming to the world the God of Jesus Christ. Worship, Christian worship, isn't just about adoring something. It isn't just about gathering and singing songs that make us feel good. Christian worship is about being attentive to the God in whom we live and move and have our being, the God revealed in Jesus Christ, and it is about a public proclamation of that God to the world. We worship God the Creator, God the Incarnate, God the Spirit of life. And that worship sets us apart. Christian worship is countercultural. It doesn't fit with the rest of our lives or the rest of what our world does. We are in a self-affirming, individualistic society. And worship is about God-affirming. Worship, even if we are alone, is a communal activity. A few weeks ago, I talked about the Apostles' Creed and we talked about the communion of saints. We are surrounded by a great host of witnesses. They are in the very walls of our buildings and in the pages of our Bible and in the letters that we read to one another. We are surrounded by faith. And we are not alone, even if we are worshiping by ourselves. Christian worship is not alone. For we are attentive to God, It's not individualistic, it's communal. It's not self-focused, it is God-focused. We live in a very cynical, critical world. We practice criticizing and complaining as a national sport. All you have to do is turn on the television. Tune into some sports channel, some big game, and you'll see some retired athletes critiquing those who are playing the game. "Well, Bob, that was a powerful hit by young Leroy, but do you think he'll have that kind of power 10 years from now?" Or tune in the news. Whether it's Fox News or NPR, you'll hear them critiquing whatever the president or national politicians just did. But in worship, we have an attitude of gratitude. We have an attentiveness to what God has already done, to God's glory, God's greatness, God's love, God's grace. The psalmist says, "Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord glory, do his name, for great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised." In worship, we praise and honor God. We proclaim God's greatness to the world. For every car parked outside a church, every person who sets aside an appointment or a sports game to take time for worship, everybody who says, "Hey, I'm going to go home and catch my church service on the internet tonight," makes a proclamation by worship about the God who is in Jesus Christ. The psalmist says, "Say among the nations, the Lord is King." By setting aside time for worship, we proclaim that God is King of our lives. I mean, what can we give to the God who gives us so much? What can we give to the infinite one other than our words of praise, other than our attentiveness, other than our blessings? The only thing we give God is our worship. We acknowledge that God is God, the Lord above the gods of our life, the Lord above all the other things that claim power over us. We proclaim that God is the Almighty, the great provider, the great caregiver, that God has the central focus of our lives, though other voices clamor around us and though other things claim our attention. When we worship, we proclaim God is central. In today's culture, words are cheap. No one really expects us to keep our promises or to be too inconvenienced because we said something. But from the earliest days, Christians were not just about words, but about actions. In the book of James, we see very clearly that the worshiping community was expected to put their faith into action. James warns about the dangers of the tongue, warned them not to talk about how God loves us all, and then show partiality, one to the rich and against the poor. James warns us that if we proclaim that God loves us all in our worship, we must respond in our actions to love everyone. And James warns us, if we're going to talk in our worship about how God cares for us and how God loves us, we dare not turn our back on a brother or sister in need. We worship Jesus when we obey his teachings, when we do his will in his name, when we care for someone in need, when we set aside our wants and we serve others. We exalt this God of ours when we live and act like Jesus, when we, in our worship and in our actions, proclaim that we are part of the kingdom of God. In praising and honoring God, we find that we are united to one another. for this is the God of creation. This is our Heavenly Father. This is the one who is above all and over all. And so we are connected to all. To others who are gathering for worship, and even to others who have the presence of God in the world around them, but are failing to acknowledge it, failing to catch it, failing to name it. Sometimes there are truly religious people in our world who aren't in church, aren't in any worship. They see God in the world, they're deeply impressed, but they just don't have the right word, don't have the right idea, don't have the right way to express it. In engaging people outside our church, we humbly realize that God has already been in their lives and can also name it for them, proclaim it with them, that God is a good and gracious God. Christian worship is not just about words, it's about actions. But it's not just about our actions. It's about God's word in action. The early Christians distinguished themselves by the idea that the Spirit was laid upon each of them, and that they could listen for God's word, and that God would be part of each of their lives. Each week when we gather and listen for the scriptures, we say, "This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." And we are attentive to listen for that word in our lives as the scriptures are proclaimed. But it's not just in the words of the pastor. It's in the words of the hymns. It's in the fellowship of believers. It's in the stained glass. It's in the stains on our Bible. God doesn't just speak through me, but God does indeed speak. Worship is not just about our actions, but about being attentive to God and God's actions. Worship is like that. It is countercultural. It is communal. It is other-oriented. It inspires gratitude and thankfulness. It demands actions, not just words. And it's not just about our actions, but about God's actions. That kind of worship, that kind of heart-filled, life-filled worship starts as we gather as God's people on Sunday and flows throughout our lives, for that's what Christians do. We worship. Amen. As we prepare for communion, let us join together in the Apostles' Creed as it's printed on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Today we gather around the table, and I invite you to pause the video and to gather some bread and some juice to share in this together. For though we are apart, the Spirit of God surrounds us and connects us as the body of Christ. We gather not just remembering the night on which Jesus was betrayed, in which he broke the bread and poured the cup, but we gather also looking forward to the day when we will gather together as the people of God. For we are told that there will be a day when we gather from north and south and east and west, and we sit at the table of our Lord and feast together as the people of God. And so we break this bread and drink this cup, looking back and looking forward. Though you may be doing this alone in your home, we do this together. For we break a loaf, remembering a common loaf. And we drink a cup, remembering a common cup, knowing that the Spirit of Christ connects us. One of our confessions says, who should come to the table of our Lord? Those who are displeased with themselves, yet nevertheless trust in the grace of Jesus Christ. And so we come, letting go of our sin and receiving the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Gracious Savior, pour out your Spirit upon us. Surround us with your love and mercy. Touch our hearts and our lives, that we might be sustained for our work in the world, that we might be encouraged and strengthened in love for one another and for you. Bless us, O Lord, as we break this bread, that we might serve faithfully as your body at work in the world. For you, our Savior, Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us that it was on the night of his arrest that Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it, said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in memory of me." The body broken, that we who are broken might be made whole, eat of it. Supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you. Drink of it. The mercy of our Lord poured out for us all. Drink of it." Let us pray. Lord, as we gather in this feast of your table, we're mindful of the community of your people spread around the world, and we pray, O Lord, for your people. We pray particularly for churches struggling in poverty, for those who are struggling in desperate situations, overwhelmed by health issues and economic worries. We pray, Lord, for missionaries who continue to proclaim good news amidst sad and tragic situations, those who risk their lives or set aside the wealth of the world so that they might be able to proclaim to your people hope and love. We pray, O Lord, in thankfulness for your powerful word proclaimed from large churches, from cathedrals and stadiums, from worship sanctuaries that are packed full of people. And we pray in thankfulness for the opportunity to worship alone on our sofa and be connected to you and to your people. Lord, as we pray for your church in the world, we pray, Lord, that we might work as your people, living out your life to the world. We pray, Lord, that we might have a heart for the least and the lost, and that we might be mindful of those who are disadvantaged by the color of the skin or by their economics. We pray, Lord, that we who are wealthy and wise with schooling and opportunities might also be humbled. Humble and serving you, O Lord, that we might realize that we have been blessed beyond measure. So, Lord, to whom much is given, much is required. May we faithfully serve you with all that we have. Lord, we're mindful of those in our church family who are struggling. We pray for those on our prayer list, for those going through chemo, for those in hospice, for those struggling with the ups and downs of age and their health concerns. We pray in thankfulness for the opportunity to worship outdoors and to sing your praises in our chapel, and for the opportunity to worship online. May your Spirit continue to bless and encourage us. We ask your guidance upon our session as you lead them into this next season of life. May you inspire us to have energy, imagination, intelligence, and love, all in service to you and to your kingdom. We ask this in the name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Change.
to the one who is able to do far more than we might ask or imagine. To God be the glory. And the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and abide upon us all, now and evermore. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you.